Hey everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson, here with Luis Scott-Vargas, and at this point, he seems like a regular Paulo, Vitor, Damo, Rosa. We're here with the last kind of spoiler show for Dark Ascension, although the set's been spoiled. We've seen all the cards. We're not going to stop here and be like, well...
Let's not call it a spoiler show. Let's just call it a first impressions show.
Sure, first impressions show. I feel like, what's that dating show from the 80s where the guy sat? Chuck Woolery and,
Is that the one where he interviewed a serial killer? Because at one point there was on one of these dating shows, the one where like the woman can't see the man and there's the three men. Is that what you're talking about? At one point there
love got, connection.
Yeah. Got at one there. Point, one of the guys on it ended up actually being a serial killer.
Yeah. Paulo didn't see it.
But he's shaking his head at the camera.
For today's non sequitur. You know.
But 2% of our audience.
Look it up on Wikipedia. It's actually very funny and disturbing.
Well, that's spectacular. So
oddest intro we've ever had, by a mile.
Great, but it's a perfect segue. Dark and disturbing.
Dark Ascension.
Dark Ascension. I just have a list of questions for you guys to go over now that we've got the set. We've come out. I don't really know where the... Let's start with maybe an easy one here. Now that we've seen all the flip cards, we know there aren't going to be any in Avacyn Restored. You've seen them all. What's your favorite?
The Elbrus, the Blinding or Binding Blade.
Same.
I mean, that's the coolest.
I mean, for someone that was so vehemently against flip cards, now that you've seen all that they're going to give us...
Oh, I'm still against them.
No, this card makes them all worth it.
I finally get a 7-mana equipment that turns into a giant guy that gets bigger when other players die.
I do kind of feel like a +1/+0 is a little weak on the card. Since, like, when you find a giant
it'd be
demon
like
magic...
+5/+5. Yeah, the card would be the exact same.
Yeah, when you find a giant demon magic sword, I mean, they're not a +1 sword. They're like a +5 sword.
It reminds me a lot of, like, with the Tatsuhuma, the...
Tatsumasa, the Dragon's Fang.
Played a lot of Champions Block. Or, you know, Sword of Cauldra, these kind of things. Like, go big. Instead, this card kind of has kind of like a genie in the lamp kind of feeling, where it's like the lamp's kind of innocuous, and then...
I guess it's a little dagger or something, maybe, too, right? Yeah, like, and then you just, like, stab him with it.
So 5 to 8 years from now, when we get like, you know, Arabian Nights callback with flip cards, there's going to be this sweet little innocuous lamp. That's gonna
the genie of the lamp.
Yeah
that's going to be sweet.
Giant genie. There you go. Bam. Submitted.
Itty bitty lamp.
So universal here. The blade, the favorite flip card. Hands down.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, are there any like good constructed flip cards?
I guess the Huntmaster of the Fells.
Yeah, Huntmaster of the Fells is gonna be the best one.
I like Mayor.
Like Mayor. I like Cloistered Youth.
I do. I don't like the cards that don't flip back because they feel like they only exist because flip cards exist.
Yeah,
and they could very easily be like Ludovic's Experiment could be like a leveling card.
It is a leveling.
Yeah, it doesn't have to flip back, and neither does Clustered Youth. But the Mayor I like because it's just completely flavorful.
Yeah,
it's like the Mayor who becomes the chief werewolf, and it's actually playable in at some points. So like it's a good limited card, and it could be good in block. It could be good in standard.
Yeah.
So it's probably the one I like the most overall.
And there, I mean, you obviously want the backside a lot more than the front, but the front side has merit.
Yeah, like, it was like, he pumps off humans when he's a human, pumps the wolves when he's a wolf.
I like it. Talking about mechanics from Dark Ascension, Undying seems pretty straightforward. The power level seems pretty straightforward. The way it works seems pretty straightforward. But let's talk about Fateful Hour. How do you feel it came out as a mechanic? Like on the cards that you've seen them all.
It's kind of interesting because there are a couple like, cards that I think are going to be playable that have Fateful Hour. And I think the key, as with most abilities, is that you want it to be playable without it and then just better with it.
Yeah. I like that it brings a completely new mechanic to games.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes you just don't want to attack them. Like, imagine you're playing Limited, you're going to attack them from 6 to 5. Sometimes you just don't want to do it.
Yeah.
And that is very interesting. It feels like a mechanic to me. It's a natural mechanic. It's the mechanic that they print, and you think, whoa, how hasn't this happened before?
Yeah, and that's always a sign of a great one. It's like when they started the booster drafting from the last set forward, right?
Yeah.
And they reversed it. Now it's like, why haven't we always done this? It makes so much more sense. So, yeah, it's just a home run. Like, Fateful Hour is great. Like,
even is there one that stands out specifically, like, might be constructed playable?
Gather the Townsfolk is probably the best one right now.
Yeah, it is playable enough without the Fateful Hour, and it's just a bonus, just what you want it to be.
Yeah, I mean, something like Gather the Townsfolk and the guy, the three-bin like Doomsayer or whatever, that gives all your guys +2/+2, you could make a Fateful Hour deck with something like Hex Parasite. That seems less likely to be good to me.
Yeah.
But Fateful Hour in a deck with Champion of the Parish and Honor of the Pure seems still very good, and sometimes it'll, you know, make 5/2/2 guys, and then they're in trouble.
Yeah, I remember we had like this fantasy card in the Brazilian website, and a guy submitted 2 mana, deals 3 damage. If you're 5 or less life, deals 5 damage. It was a while ago. It just felt very natural. Yeah. It's just a good card. They could print that next set.
Yeah, they very easily could.
Yeah.
They're not going to because the mechanic ends here. But
there's no more Fateful Hours. This is the only time there's Fateful Hours.
Not in the next set?
Well, Captain Flavor over here. Come on, it's Avacyn Restored next time around.
It is not a Fateful Hour.
No.
Sure, but
all the you know.
It's
like
it starts with the Fateful Hour, then it's restored.
Yes. Right.
Then once it's restored, the Fateful Hour is over.
But it is a mechanic that you could see in a random card. Like you didn't need a name for it. You could just print a card and have that be part of the
card.
In
the future, I think that something like this could be an easy callback. Because again, when we've removed Mana Burn, so much more space.
I mean, and most sets have something exciting going on, so you could say a Fateful Hour is occurring in pretty much any set, right?
You're reaching a bit there. That's a good screen capture face right there. again, cycles are a lot of fun in sets. A lot of talk about the increasing cycle. Now that we've seen all five, which was the most interesting? Do you think any of these cards are playable in Constructed, or are they just kind of fun?
Which cycle?
They're like, if you play it from your graveyard, double.
Yeah, you do twice as much. So there's the mill one, which is really straightforward.
As was rightfully pointed out in the comments last time, the only reason we weren't talking about the mill one is because we wanted to keep it a secret.
Right.
It was too good. if I ever die to an Invisible Stalker with like 10 +1/+1 counters on it, I will not be happy.
Yeah. Or any creature with 10 +1/+1 counters on it, really.
All right, Moto.
Yes.
Challenge given.
Yeah.
Achievement to be unlocked.
These cards are all, decent limited cards, decent to good limited cards, but I don't think you have time in Constructed to cast an overcosted spell, then flash them back an overcosted spell.
Yeah. I mean, if they were good to begin with.
Right, the fork doesn't hit opponent's spells. It's like.
That is the best of them, I think, though.
Yeah.
The green one is the weakest, like, in Constructed.
Yeah, it's kind of like Angelic Destiny-ish.
Yeah. The black one's pretty bad, too.
Isn't it like an
5 mana Demonic Tutor, 8 mana Double Demonic Tutor?
Yeah.
I mean, Double Demonic Tutor is powerful, but 8 mana, 5 mana, these cards just don't work for, like, Constructed.
Yeah, if there were, like, Alchemy, for example, like, 3 mana, do something that you were fine with, and then, like, flashback 9 cards deep, then they would be good.
Like, if the Demonic Tutor was, like, triple black Demonic Tutor, like, Beseech the Queen, maybe triple black and 1, right, because Beseech the Queen is already even good enough. Like, triple black and 1, and then, but then, like, 8 flashback double DT, like, that would be pretty interesting.
It's still triple black and one?
I mean, you can't just make it Diabolic Tutor.
You could. It's not like the card is super overpowered.
Yeah, okay, maybe just make it Diabolic Tutor with like an 8 mana flashback. That card would be good, I think.
It would be decent.
Yeah.
Have your draft strategies initially changed at all now that you're going to be drafting this set first? Are there color combinations of evaluating differently, or are werewolves any better, or vampires any better? Anything you've kind of seen on the surface that you're like, oh, I'm really interested in first picking this card, and that's going to change like the avenues I'm going to go down?
Mostly Zombie Apocalypse. I'm interested in playing with that card.
But there's no clear, like, like it's not like the Burning Vengeance strategy is any better if you're going to open up a Secrets of the...
Well, you have less Burning Vengeances for it to be
there. And, I mean, Secrets is good, but in that deck, you want Burning Vengeance, I think, more than Secrets a lot of the time.
Probably. But you're going to see Secrets more because the set is smaller.
Yeah. But, like, when you're flashing back Dream Twists and Think Twices, you actually would rather be shocking things than drawing a card. Because, like, fill your deck full of do-nothing cantrips and kill them with Burning Vengeance or kill a creature with Burning Vengeance. You just draw more do-nothing cantrips, and you have to actually have something in your deck. I think, like, the Burning Vengeance and Spider-Spawning decks got worse, even though they did get new tools, like the green card that flashes back for blue that, like, lets you, like, commune with nature, discard them, then flash it back.
Mulch for creatures.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the creature mulch.
There's definitely more interesting cycles of the flashback at a different colored cards. I mean, the Shimmering Grotto goes slightly up in draft pick order now. I mean, Traveler's Amulets. I mean, how many of these cards were playable to begin with, with just the two-color combination? Again, the Commune with Nature one seems like it might be the best for limited to the ones.
It's still a good card, the Creature Mulch or whatever kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, it's a good card even when you're not comboing. Like, just a solid card. It's going to be very good in that deck, but losing a pack of Spider Spawning is really bad because that's the most important card for the deck.
And the flashback, really, it sets it apart from a card like Lead the Stampede, which would, in Mirrodin, like...
I mean, and to putting in a graveyard thing.
Yeah.
You're actually one card in your graveyard.
Yeah, it's like an additional bonus.
Okay. So not too much thoughts on draft yet.
I mean, we haven't drafted.
We haven't done anything.
It's hard to say exactly what's going to go
on. You guys reserve your judgment until 2 weeks from now when you have a lot of time to actually just play limited.
Right.
Yeah.
You don't have to make any snap judgments right now. So you don't necessarily have a favorite draft common that you've seen so far?
Oh, Zombie Apocalypse.
The removal's not spectacular in this set.
I mean, the shock that flashes back for six, is that a common or an uncommon?
That's a common. It's red to cast and then black.
I don't really know if it's the best common, but it's certainly good.
Well, if we're talking about removal, I think Zombie Apocalypse is pretty good at killing things, humans specifically.
I'm going to have to change my questions here because they're all going to be answered with Zombie Apocalypse.
Only when it's appropriate to do so.
There was so much we talked about how sweet the artwork and how that connected to flavor in Innistrad. What's your favorite piece of artwork from Dark Ascension? I'm gonna go with Paulo here because I know it.
I don't actually know all the arts.
Nothing that's like stood out like that you've seen at any point in any of the cards that you've seen.
No.
Nothing. Nothing has. Not like the Death's Caress, the hand over the face.
What about Undying Evil?
Yeah, I was very disappointed with the name Undying Evil.
You were disappointed with the name, with the card
that was linked to the name. Because I read Undying Evil, and I thought it was going to be like, damn, damn, all your creatures have undying, or whatever. Like, something
recurring nightmare. Something really sweet.
And then something very powerful. And it's just like one mana, gains
your guy gets
intimidated. Why is this called Undying Evil? What a waste of a card name.
And then there's like the zombie crawling out of the cellar with like the rune in its forehead, like that. It looks like it would be a more impressive card, even just from art alone.
I mean, you could have the Undying Evil. It could be like an entity or something.
Yeah.
Instead, it's Intimidate.
No, it's Undying.
So thanks for having Paulo.
It's not Intimidate, is it? Isn't it Undying?
No. I think it's one mana gives Intimidate, isn't it?
It
gives Undying?
Undying.
That would make more sense than Intimidate. Evil?
Yes.
It's
Undying.
I'm actually...
Okay, that makes more sense.
It's not just a strictly reverse version of Gruesome Discovery. Or
I thought it had Flashback.
Oh.
I just have no idea what the cards do.
I think Faith Shield has some good artwork. Restless Scab, like the scabs coming off the wall of spikes.
I'm kind of a fan of Zombie Apocalypse.
I think the artwork isn't even that exciting.
It's a zombie apocalypse.
Just some zombies. I think Army of the Damned looks way better.
Army of the Damned looks pretty awesome. That's what happens after. It's like a number one, number two shot.
I think the number one shot is Army of the Damned. The number two shot is your opponent trying to cast Bar the Door like it's going to do anything.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Get +0/+4, but I'm still dead.
Yeah.
Well, that was weak. That was weak. Now you guys are about to leave to Hawaii. I mean,
a couple days, like 3 days from now.
After you leave here today, you make one public appearance for the pre-release, and then you're gone, whisked away, as it were. Have you really started to think about Standard with this set yet?
We've thought about it. We haven't played yet.
Okay. But now, initial impressions: Standard with Arc Ascension.
I mean, a lot of decks get upgrades. I think Evolving Wilds and Thought Scour go into a lot of decks, or like Ponder Evolving Wilds. Like, Evolving Wilds has got to be the biggest card in the new set.
Maybe, yeah. Which is very weird, because it is not a good card at all.
No.
But yeah, it's going to be important, I think, in a way that it makes you rethink what, like, you challenge your previous conclusions.
Yeah.
Because some decks are playable now that weren't before, and you just have to try them again.
Yeah.
Now, is the standard, is like what you're kind of matching things up against initially, just kind of like the interactions between Snapcaster Mage and Magic cards and like Geist of St. Traft, it being in the format. It seems like, you know, just with Moto results, that those are the cards that are really kind of defining where Standard is at right now. So if you're looking at any card in Dark Ascension, are these the first cards you're matching them up against, or are you looking at a wider range?
Probably.
Kind of,
like Stranglehold Geist, for example. Like, part of the reason I think he's going to be played is because he's very good against Geist.
Wait, Geist is good against Geist?
Yes. It's a Geist battle.
Who'd have Geist it? I think when I first think about a deck, I don't necessarily say, like, what does it do against Delver? What does it do against Primeval Titan? What does it do against, Stormcloak Noble? What does it do against, Doom Traveler? Because it's actually a big game. But you do have to take into account these things. First, I start with a deck that I think just is inherently powerful enough and has good enough synergy. And then once it gets like a little more fully formed, then you start looking at the individual matchups and thinking, like, what is it going to do against this? But I don't build a deck and say, how does this deck deal with Primeval Titan? I just think, how does this deck do against that kind of deck?
Yeah, I guess like big creatures or whatever. Yeah.
Now on the other side, were there any highlights from Dark Ascension that you're like, that's a starting point for a deck? That's like, I want four of these and do something else.
I mean, Lidrian Souls and Soaring.
Yeah. Loitering Souls, they just won't go home. And Sorin, yeah. I mean, they're Loitering Souls even more than Sorin actually pushes black-white tokens.
But I think they
both push black-white tokens. Or a tokens deck playing black, at the very least.
So a week ago, before we'd seen the whole set, these were things we'd kind of talked about.
Yeah.
Now, Did that kind of archetype or color combination get anything else from the rest of the spoiler, or is it still strong enough on its own that that might be the first 8 out of 75?
Yeah, I don't think it got anything else. It gets the Vault of the Archangel, but we had that already.
Yeah.
So I don't think of the new, like, 80 cards that were spoiled, any actually goes in that deck.
We didn't even finish that land cycle. How disappointing was
that?
Very.
I was like, the whole spoiler, and I kept looking for the land.
Yeah, and the only one they had was the black green one.
Yeah.
Like, who cares about black green lands?
Yeah, we need the red blue one.
Yeah, or the blue green. I would be happy with blue green.
Connolly played a deck with four Woodland Cemetery at the GP, didn't he?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so Connolly was still probably not played that land.
Odds on Connolly.
Sack your Solemn?
Whoa, go big.
It's a good value land to get.
Yeah, Sack your Titan.
When your Titan attacks for the third time and you've left in your deck.
Exactly. But if we're talking about new cards that push you in a certain direction, Giralf's Messenger, the new Kitchen Stinks, that guy's good. He's very powerful. He's one of the most powerful cards in the set, actually. A 3/2 that drains him for 2, then comes back as a 4/3 and also drains him for 2. I mean, can you imagine this card 5 years ago or something?
Yeah, it would be ridiculous.
Yeah. Triple Black is tough.
It's very good now.
Yeah, it's very good now. And I mean, Triple Black is tough. Like, with the way the mana is, but you could even still splash color if you really wanted to, or just play mono black. There might be enough good cards for mono black now.
Could mono black really be competitive in standard though?
I think so.
Everyone wants the answer to be yes.
Yeah. It's not mono black control.
No.
Right. We agree. I mean, but a deck with like everyone's, you know, Messenger, Obliterator, removal spells,
and
Lash Rife.
Here's the problem, and Paulo's article even kind of addressed this when you wrote about standard. Is your 2-drop is a 2-mana 2/1 fear.
Yeah. You're kind of limited. You know, like, your sideboard is probably going to be horrible. It's going to be like 7 discard spells and 8 removal spells.
Yeah. You're kind of limited, like, that's a card you should only play in limited.
And Black Cat is no Ravenous Rats, which would really, really hope that it had been a
Black
zombie.
Black Cat would have been sweet, but no.
Yeah.
But yeah, your sideboard's going to be terrible because Mono Black never has a good sideboard.
I mean, the problem with this deck has always been that you have some good cards that push you in that direction. Say, Obliterator is a very powerful card. But the context is bad. Like, you have to play a bunch of bad cards because you're mono black so that you can play Obliterator.
Yeah.
But at some point, you're going to get a critical mass of awesome black-only cards that you only have to play those. So if you could play, like, 36 Obliterator power level cards, there would be no problem in playing mono black.
I don't think 36 Obliterators would win very much.
Power level cards, not 36 Obliterators.
Messenger goes
That's
a long...
That's also not legal.
Messenger goes a long way for making
it's
that
It's another
happen.
One of those. Like, if he was the only one, well, it's not worth playing mono black, which is inferior to other decks because of him. But now you have like Left Right, Obliterator, Messenger. All those are kind of worth playing Mono Black for.
Yeah.
And once you put them all together, maybe the deck is good.
More of the two that aren't Lash Right. Lash Right's like.
Sure.
It's okay. It's not bad.
And even something like Distress Liliana that you can just cast as soon as you get like the required mana.
I mean, this deck, assuming you have 36 spell slots, you know, it has a pretty solid like 28 good spells.
Yeah.
And its last 8 cards are like. 2/1 fear zombies.
Yes.
My only other problem with it is, right now in standard, it could never really be a deck because if it ever got good enough, there's like Snapcaster Celestial Purge. Like,
yeah, that is a big problem.
Celestial Purge, especially like Giralf's Messenger. I mean, you still lose 2 life, but it also kills Gravecrawler for good.
And Obliterator.
Yeah.
So if anything, like it seems like maybe Mono Black could be good for an instance, and then like all these decks would just put it in check.
I mean, if you have if you add Snapcaster, then it's probably very bad for you. But if you got a random deck playing like 2 purges, that's not the end of the world.
Yeah, but I mean, look at it this way: times people think mono black is good, times mono black is actually good.
Yeah.
And Paulo's actually saying, and this is Paulo, that mono black might be good, which is goes a long way. I mean, you would never say that.
I mean, it's never good.
Yeah.
No.
So, I don't know. I think Giralf's Messenger, Obliterator, and Liliana are all like cards that are like pretty good. So.
So looking at the whole set going into Constructed, I think the keynote cards to take away from here, Loitering Souls, thank you, Luis, Sorin, maybe
they
Messenger.
Just keep coming back.
Obviously Zombie Apocalypse. Any cards beyond that that are just like, on day one of testing for the Pro Tour, that you're like, I want to start using these Dark
Master
Ascension
of the
cards.
Fells is a card we're gonna try.
You're just going to leave that to Kibler, though. Like, you guys aren't actually going to do
She's
anything.
Already got the deck proxied, probably.
Yeah. It's on our team forum.
Yeah.
I mean, String Rule with Guys
is
a good card.
Okay.
But I think people are going to try attacking with it. And I don't think that's, like, I don't think green Stompy decks are good, like green red or whatever. I think it's way better as a blocker. Like, you just play it, you block 2 creatures, they can't do anything about it, and then you play a Titan. That's how I think it would be played.
Yeah, it's like a Viridian Emissary, but instead of a land, you get a 3-2.
A 3-2, yes. And it makes a lot of difference. When they have Geist, if Regen Emissary, they gutshot it. Yeah. Like, a land is a lot worse than a 3-2.
Yes, I will agree with that. So, I mean, we've got some pretty solid cards in the set. Like, yeah, upon initial impression, when I say something like Evolving Wild is the most important card, it's like, oh, this set must suck.
Right.
But that's not the case. I think the set
it's the meta base in Standard that sucks, which is why Evolving Wild.
Yeah, it's so the set actually has some pretty good stuff. So, I would not be surprised to see.
No, not a lot. Like, like for example, blue. The only playable blue card is Dementor.
I kind of like Dungeon Geists, actually.
Well, the Sword of Temptation.
Sword of Temptation. Instead of stealing the guy, it taps it only, which is much, much worse. But it's a 3-3. So I don't know. I think the card might be okay.
I don't know. Sideboardable in some matchups.
Yeah, the thing is, Sword is so good because the upside is worth the downside. It's just not a good card.
Yeah.
And this, I don't know if the upside
having
is...
Having one additional toughness doesn't seem that big.
No.
No. But if it was four, it would be...
Look,
even though nowadays, no one
does. When we're saying no blue cards are playable,
sure, it's playable. At some point, someone's going to play it.
I would say this card is, you know, a little better.
Luis is trying.
Sure, sure.
Luis is
and the Secret Swing, like maybe there is a deck with like Burning Vengeance and flashback spells.
Yeah.
Like it's not completely unplayable, but.
Yeah, blue got kind of the short end of the stick. Yeah. It always gets the short end of the stick.
Yeah. The only card I would immediately add to a deck is the Mental Note.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, there you have it. That's. All of the initial thoughts of Dark Ascension. Looking forward to seeing. It's strange actually that standard implications are going to come kind of supersede limited implications, which is usually the first thing you look at when a new set comes out. But you guys have the PT to play. There's a lot of standard going on.
There's limited too, so we'll be doing both.
Yeah,
we'll be testing our zombie apocalypse decks.
I swear, there's going to be. I picture. There's going to be some PT coverage. There's going to be a Luis draft. Maybe a viewer. Maybe an interview. Who knows? Maybe even a deck tech. And it's going to be like, well, yes, I open Zombie Apocalypse. Yeah. And
there's going to be a very good card in Zombie Apocalypse.
And then, two very good cards.
And then I'm going to have to just beg Ben Stark to stop here before going back home.
Exactly.
And be like, please break this down for us.
I guess those are our initial thoughts on this set and Zombie Apocalypse. Thanks for watching.